Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I believe we're scheduled to conduct this session from 3 till 3:45. Is that what your schedule says? All right, we're on the same page. So I'd like to get started now. Many of you have read various writings by Murray Rothbard. And if so, you've almost certainly run across a term called the welfare warfare state. Murray coined this term in the late 1960s. And since that time, many Rothbardians have adopted it and used it as a way of characterizing the kind of political economy that exists both in the United States and in a number of other countries around the world. It's interesting to compare different names that people give to this reigning political economy. For many years, I've used a term that I borrowed from a student of mine, Charlotte Twight, which she first used back in the 1970s in a book she wrote before she was my student, and that is the term participatory fascism. And so I'm very fond of that term, but welfare warfare state is a good term too, and more literal in some ways. Now, if I had been sitting with Murray when he concocted this term, I might have actually advised him to turn it around, because in my mind the warfare state is something that precedes and actually embodies the welfare state. The welfare state sounds soft and cuddly as compared with the warfare state that sounds hard and vicious. But as I emphasized in my talk yesterday, the warfare state is one in which the government goes to war not only against foreign enemies, but also against the people it purports to be protecting and representing. And the welfare state, although it sounds warm and cuddly and helpful and generous, and all those things that progressives associate with it, is in a sense impossible unless the government first goes to war against the people. In order to have the means to pay for the benefits that government dispenses under the umbrella term welfare state, the government must first steal or extort the money in order to make these payments or purchase these benefits in kind. So the warfare state and the welfare state are intimately related. And if one looks at the history of the development of the welfare state, one sees a series of episodes in which that connection is quite clear. And I'll discuss some of those instances in this session. Now, many people, especially those who haven't studied the welfare state very much, tend to associate it with the New Deal in the United States, with government policies adopted by the Roosevelt administration during the Great Depression of the 1930s. If one does that, one is starting off his understanding on completely the wrong foot. And it, in a sense, gives far too much credit or blame to Roosevelt and the Rooseveltians than they deserve. They were carrying out policies and using ideas that had been around for some time already, and they were in many cases simply expanding or adopting models that had been in use sometimes for 50 years or more somewhere in the world, sometimes in this country, sometimes only in other countries. But another idea that lay people often have is that until the welfare state was created, people who were destitute were helpless. They had no one to assist them in hardship, or when they were sick or too old to work or otherwise unable to care for themselves. And this is the worst kind of myth. It was never, ever, as far as we know anything about human beings, never the case that people who were too old to care for themselves or too sick or hurt and unable to take care of themselves were simply abandoned and thrown to the wolves. That is not the nature of human beings. So when people were in hardship, where did they get their help? Well, they got it mainly from their relatives, from their kinfolk. They got it from neighbors, from people who belonged to the same church or other private association they were connected with. So people used their civil associations and their familial associations as sources of assistance during times of hardship. And there was nothing extraordinary about this, but people didn't think for centuries of the family as a welfare institution. That is just what families did. People cared for their relatives. Well, the family has weakened over time, and that was one of the reasons why proponents of the welfare state thought that we needed a welfare state. That they argued very often that the family relationships that people had depended upon earlier were no longer reliable, that families were too unstable, they were too split up by migration or other movements that tore family members apart from one another and made it more difficult for them to look after each other. And so the state, in a sense, they thought had to step into the gap. But as it turned out, even if that were to some extent the case, once the state started stepping in to fill the gap, it also had the effect of crowding out the remaining voluntary efforts to take care of people. It then became easier for relatives to say, oh, my brother's in trouble, but I don't need to help him. The state will help him. My parents are too old to work, but I don't need to care for them because the state will give them a pension. My cousin is sick, and I don't need to care for him because the state has sickness insurance, health insurance. And so even if the argument had some validity in the first place, once the welfare state was created and began to operate, it had the effect of crowding out voluntary efforts. Now, obviously, it never completely crowded those efforts out, because a great many of them still occur today. There are many, many private organizations of various kinds, some church-related, some related to unions and ethnic associations and a whole variety of groups that help their members out in times of hardship. But it's also still the case that family members assist one another, and the family remains the most important social unit. You see this, for example, in the extreme cases like the countries that adopted communism. The communists tried to eliminate all intervening organizations, all these private organizations that had grown up over the centuries, including those associated with the churches. They tried to destroy. They tried to create a situation in which individuals were connected to the mighty nation state and nothing stood between the two. And that included the family, because the communists did such despicable things as encourage family members to act as informants to the police against one another. And this is one of the most horrifying aspects of life under communism. I've spoken to a number of people who lived in Central Europe or in Russia about the fact that you couldn't trust anybody except your closest family members. One woman I knew used to describe how she and her mother and father lived in an apartment would go to the side of the apartment to talk about certain things because they knew that on the other side of the apartment was a neighbor who listened to them through the wall with a stethoscope. Imagine living like that. This is horrifying. Of course, this happens now to us without the stethoscope because we have the NSA and the FBI and all the rest of these electronic snooping agencies that watch our every move and don't require the presence of a human being to act as an informant. We're all informing on ourselves if we have a phone in our pocket. And yet we're so accustomed to this technology that it doesn't occur to us that we're in almost the same position as people lived in under communism in the USSR, watched at all times, monitored, our words recorded, our messages recorded, our mail photographed, our checks and credit card transactions photographed and recorded and placed in gigantic databases linked to one another so that whenever some authority wants to call up information on us, one or two clicks tells him everything there is to know about us. That's a horrifying world, and we're living in it right now. But that's an aside. Meanwhile, back at the birth of the welfare state, we can actually go back to the 16th century in England, because we're talking in this session about the United States, and the origins of this country lie in the English colonists who came here in the 17th, 18th centuries and set up colonies that later formed the United States of America. When these English people came over, they brought with them the full set of English customs and practices. And one of those customs was the system of poor relief that we can trace back to several statutes enacted in the 16th century, first under the Tudors, and especially under Elizabeth I, the Queen of England for a long time in the 16th century. These laws can be traced further back to labor shortages after the Black Death, to the existence of many beggars wandering around in England and other parts of Europe without employment. Some of these people unable to work, some unable to find work, but reduced to begging. And there was little tolerance for begging in England, and probably little tolerance on the continent as well. But at all events in England, beggars were treated as criminals, basically. They were punished, and they were sometimes killed for a second offense. Gradually, the severity of the system lightened somewhat, but it remained severe to the very end. The idea was that people didn't want to support anyone who wasn't working to support himself if it were at all possible for that person to work, to support himself. Now, under the system of poor relief in England, there were two different kinds, one called indoor relief and another outdoor relief. In outdoor relief, a person lived somewhere on his own but could receive food and perhaps some clothing from the local parish officials. The whole system was organized at the parish level. The parish, of course, is an ecclesiastical unit of jurisdiction, but in England, there was a state church, so the civil government and the religious government were actually one and the same, and many state functions were carried out by the church authorities or by churchmen themselves. Indeed, the whole system of the poor laws, as it came down after the 16th century, was an upshot of Henry VIII's declaring the Church of England independent from the Catholic Church headed by the Pope in Rome. And when he did that, he plundered the church, and that included plundering the monasteries And the monasteries had been the principal dispensers of assistance to people who were unable to take care of themselves. So he had destroyed these previous providers of help, and so something had to be devised to put in place of the old monastery system. So what was put was the parish system of assistance operated by churchmen and local officials and funded by a local tax, which was usually called the poor rate, a tax on people's land values for the most part. People didn't like paying the poor rate, and they wanted to keep it as low as they could. And one way to do that was to keep the number of poor people being cared for as low as possible. And they thought the best way to do that was punish people who were asking for assistance, make it even risky for them to come forth and ask for assistance. Sometimes people were whipped, but at all events, they were never welcomed with open arms. So if you ever think like, you know, some of these right-wing Republicans are callous about the welfare system, well, at least they don't anymore propose to give floggings or execute people who go on welfare. So that's some progress. The poor system came over to the United States or to the colonies that became the United States in a little different form, because the parish organization of civil government didn't exist here. Organized churches didn't exist everywhere, and at all events, we had a more reliance here on civil government and less on church government. So the system of local relief, such as it was, and it wasn't much, existed at the county level and on an ad hoc basis at the municipal level. Cities and towns might, if there were some extreme case of distress, you know, perhaps the town had been flooded, or some terrible epidemic had struck, or something out of the ordinary had taken place and a lot of people needed help, then a town might provide temporary meals or foodstuffs. But this was not something that was done routinely or chronically. It was extraordinary. And the counties became the units where destitute people were cared for. And in this case, they were mostly cared for with indoor relief. That is, they were sent to the county poorhouse, as it was called. And it must have been called that for a long time, because when I was growing up, my parents used to speak of the threat of going to the poorhouse. So at least the term was still around. And that was to put the fear of God in us to work. You better get in gear, or you'll end up in the poorhouse, was the threat. But the counties did have these places where poor people were housed and taken care of. And often these people were not even able to work at all. They were crippled, they were old, they were mentally unfit, or in some other way, just simply couldn't take care of themselves. So in some cases, there wasn't any great question about whether they could support themselves or not. They obviously couldn't. And if they had no relatives about to support them, or they had no friends or neighbors willing to undertake the task, then they were not allowed to simply die, even if the government, which wasn't interested in doing this, had to be the ones taking care of them. So this dying in the gutter story that we hear every once in a while, at least as a term of speech, is completely a myth. There was no abandonment of destitute people ever. Now, in the colonial period and into the 19th century, the government didn't have much tax revenue at any level, but it had one resource of immense value, or at least potential value, and that is it had a great territory. The government of the United States, when it was founded, extended all the way to the Mississippi River, and that was a big enough area right there to make the United States bigger than almost every European country. It's a giant area. And in 1787, that territory was almost all uninhabited or very lightly inhabited. So what the government could do when it wanted to give people something, it couldn't give them money because it didn't have much to give, but it could give them land. And so as a reward for veterans in the nation's wars, who were often paid very little for their service, they were commonly promised land if they would serve, and then if they completed their service successfully, they would be given warrants, which were kind of claims to purchase a certain purchase or actually receive without payment a certain amount of land in stipulated territories in the West. So that's one of the reasons I was cautioning yesterday. You have to be careful when you talk about the size of government. If you look back in the early 19th century, it looks like the U.S. government is not very big. It doesn't have many resources at its disposal, but it had a continent. So that was not nothing, particularly at a time when 80% of the people were farmers or closely connected with farming for a livelihood. So veterans' pensions became quite common. Now, when the Great War took place between the states, 1861 to 1865, it created a gigantic group of veterans. The ones who had fought on the side of the Confederacy were just out of luck. If they were wounded or disabled or later on became sick, they had to use the usual resort to relatives, friends, and churchmen. But in the North, where the soldiers had always been better provided for, the North was a wealthier area than the South at the time of the war, the veterans immediately organized a lobby called the Grand Army of the Republic, the GAR. And what these guys wanted was more lavish pensions for their service during the war. And to an increasing extent, they wanted pensions not only for themselves, but for their survivors. If they died before their wives, they wanted their widows to receive a pension. Sometimes they wanted their dependent children to receive pensions. And so here we have over a million people with a strong political claim to fame. For decades after that war, the Republicans ruled national government almost without exception. Only twice was a non-Republican elected to the presidency, and that was the two terms when Grover Cleveland was elected. But otherwise, every president of the United States from Johnson on onward, up through McKinley, they were all former officers in the Union Army. And every election that took place in those days involved the Republicans campaigning on the grounds that they were the party of loyalty. They were the party who saved the nation against the rebels. And this is what historians came to describe as waving the bloody shirt. You know, don't forget us, you know, we were the guys who saved the day back in that terrible rebellion when people just wanted to leave. Can't have that. So the Republicans were quite responsive to the GAR's lobbying efforts, and so responsive, in fact, that it became scandalous. A large part of the federal budget was used to pay these veterans benefits and benefits to the family members of veterans. And many people who didn't qualify, even though it was not hard to qualify, got included in the system through what was called private bills. This was an act of Congress that said something like, the government of the United States will provide a pension to John Doe of Tipton, Ohio, for his service in the war. Well, John Doe might have been a guy whose service in the war extended no further than joining some military unit and then deserting. But if he had a friend in Congress, he might be able to get a private bill and end up with a pension anyhow. These private bills are so outrageous that when Cleveland was president, Cleveland was remarkable in that for a politician, he was astonishingly honest. Now, I emphasize he was still a politician. So consider the standard I'm employing here. But he was remarkably honest. One manifestation of his honesty was that he vetoed hundreds of these private bills. And of course, that gained him the enmity of all the Republicans who were using this great pension scheme as a vote-buying scheme. About 28%, I believe it was, of the entire federal budget in the 1880s and 90s went toward paying veterans benefits. This was a welfare system. Okay? It was the first national welfare system in the United States. Now, it didn't include everybody. It was selective. It was only for veterans and their family members. But nonetheless, it was a big deal. Okay? It was a large program with a large part of the entire federal budget. And it strengthened that model that already existed of providing benefits to veterans and made it a kind of model from that time on up to the present of providing lavish post-service benefits to people who serve in the U.S. military. In the late 19th century, socialism was becoming quite an important political movement in Europe, especially in Germany, probably more so there than anywhere else. Remember, Karl Marx was a German himself, even though he lived in London for a long time. But Marx and Engels, German guys, spent a lot of time in Germany or with other Germans, participated in the revolutionary events of 1848, which didn't get them anywhere, but in trouble. But nonetheless, these socialist wannabe revolutionaries were having more and more success in disseminating their views and getting people to become socialists and form socialist political parties, elect socialist members to some of the parliaments, including the parliament in Germany after Germany was united in 1870 and became a huge, important nation state instead of dozens of little German principalities. So this new German state was a big boy on the block, yet it had some challengers, particularly the growing socialist movement. Otto von Bismarck, who was the brains of the outfit, the new German state, had a plan. And he thought about this and he said, it's a mistake to go out and just shoot people down in the streets because of the challenge they pose to the state. That just might make them angry and actually encourage more people to join their cause if we act with too heavy a hand. Let's co-opt them. Let's take their argument away from them. They argue that capitalism is cruel, that it leaves people in distress, that it breaks men down, leaves them unable to work, it puts them in jobs where they get hurt and can't work. It leaves them in positions when they get old where they can't care for themselves anymore. We will provide benefits for these people. We'll provide sickness insurance. We'll provide accident insurance. We'll provide old age pensions. In other words, we'll provide most of the things that we now call the welfare state. As a coherent system, the welfare state was invented by the Germans of Bismarck's administration. It worked. Now, the socialist movement continued to grow in Germany, but the reason we know it worked is that the socialist movement of those days was international workers' movement. It was a movement that told workers, look, you owe nothing to the state. They're your enemy. They're the executive committee of the bourgeoisie. They're people who are just trying to exploit you. Okay? And your true comrades, your real brothers, are the workers of other nations. You know the communist motto, workers of all nations, unite. You have nothing to lose but your chains. You know that. Well, a lot of Germans acted for decades as if they believed that. But then came 1914. And in that case, good socialists would have said, of course we're not going to war against our comrades in France, our comrades in England. They're our brothers. You people in the German government are enemies. But their socialism didn't go deep enough. It was like the Missouri River, a mile wide and an inch deep. Okay? So they marched off to war by the millions and lost their lives. At the same time that socialist workers in France and socialist workers in England and other countries marched off to war and lost their lives, fighting their comrades. Tragic. This is one case where socialism actually looks good as an alternative to what people chose instead, which was military madness. Meanwhile, however, Germany had become a great model for others, including Americans. In the 19th century until the very end, the United States didn't have anything you would call an intelligentsia, a class of intellectuals. There'd been interesting people here who wrote things. We had some good writers in the middle of the 19th century and even earlier. So there were writers. There were some smart people here and there who lived the life of the mind. But there was no class of people you could point to and say, that's the American intelligentsia. In the same way, you might have been able to point to a class like that in Germany or France. But in the late 19th century, some Americans started to want to have an intelligentsia. They wanted to belong to it. And they wanted to have one like the best one on earth, which was the German one. The Germans had all these great old universities that had been there for hundreds of years, and they trained people to an advanced level in liberal arts fields like history, economics, law. And you could go to Heidelberg and you could get something called a PhD degree, Doctor of Philosophy. That was way up there. You couldn't go anywhere in the United States and get a PhD degree until 1876, when the first PhD granting university was founded in Baltimore, called Johns Hopkins University. I should have worn my Hopkins tie for this lecture, but I neglected to do that. That's where I got my PhD, strangely enough. But let me tell you, when I think about myself along with the other Hopkins PhDs, I don't feel as if I'm in completely good company. Woodrow Wilson was a graduate with a PhD from Johns Hopkins. And some other unsavory people were also graduates of that distinguished university, which now is distinguished by, among other things, being a chief contractor for the Pentagon, as it has been for decades. Lots and lots of money comes into Johns Hopkins from the Department of Defense. It's not the only one, mind you. Most major U.S. universities play the same game. But at all events, Hopkins began granting these advanced degrees, and then Harvard and Columbia and some of the others followed before long. But meanwhile, an aspiring young American intellectual really had to go to Europe and do the dirty work, and especially to Germany. So that's where they went. They marched off to Germany, and at that time, the German professors in fields like economics were mostly members of what is now called the historical school. These are, of course, the great enemies of the early Austrians, the enemies particularly of Karl Menger, the enemies of von Bawerk, the enemies later of Ludwig von Mises. Okay? They all wrote extensively against the German historical school to show how misguided its thinking was. But besides being misguided methodologically, the German historical school, to which most of those German professors belonged, was extremely statist. These professors actually looked upon the German state as almost a religious institution. It was something that wasn't just useful or helpful or necessary in, for defense purposes or some other civil purpose. The state was like the Hegelian embodiment of the highest will of the people. You know? What crap, you know? This used to be the highest order of thinking coming from these elevated German professors. And Americans went over to Germany and absorbed this kind of thinking and came back to the United States and said, look, if we're ever going to be a civilized country over here in the wilderness, we have to do things the way the Germans do things. And that includes being having a welfare state. They have a welfare state. Why don't we? We've got these workers in factories getting hurt. Nobody takes care of them. People get sick, they can't work. People get old, they can't work. Look, that doesn't happen in Germany. The government needs to start doing these things. We need to follow the elevated example of the Germans. Now, you might think that kind of thinking surely died out years ago, but no. In fact, some of the progressives, such as Hillary Clinton, very much subscribe today to the idea that if the Germans are doing it, we should be doing it too. Even in 2015, as the German welfare state is looking oblivion in the eye, and the last generation on Easy Street is enjoying their vacations in Latin America in the sun. Their children, their grandchildren aren't going to get those benefits, because the state cannot any longer finance that kind of lush transfer of income. But the German model was a great inspiration to Americans. One of the Americans who went over there was a man named Richard Ely. And if you want to read a really good description of him, go read Murray Rothbard's little vignette of Ely. His name is spelled E-L-I. E-L-Y, right, Danny? E-L-Y, I got that wrong. E-L-Y, Richard Ely. And there's a wonderful essay by Rothbard called World War I as Fulfillment. And if you just do a search on World War I as Fulfillment, you'll get direct links to the essay. It's available from the Mises Institute's website and from other places. But one section of that wonderful paper deals with Richard Ely. And Ely became almost a one-man welfare state crusader who pushed in all directions for the government to become more expansive in providing benefits to people. He hated laissez-faire. And at that time, in the late 19th century, there were still quite a few economists who followed classical economics. They were still using John Stuart Mill's textbook in their classes, you know, the height of classical economics. Or some of them had discovered neoclassical economics in the form of Marshall and Jevons and the other neoclassicals who came along in the late 19th century. But Ely and his followers hated laissez-faire. They hated, just as the historical school in Germany hated Austrian economics. In fact, they were the ones who called it Austrian economics. These guys in Berlin and Heidelberg called it Austrian economics to emphasize it was a work of a bunch of baboons down there in Austria, outlanders, you know, people who weren't in the civilized part of the German world. Austrian economics, you know? It's like the guys at Harvard calling it Arkansas economics. Which is kind of stupid when you think about it. Vienna being, you know, arguably the most civilized city on earth in those days. But that never stopped anybody who was intent on leveling an insult, did it? So anyhow, the idea of these Ely followers was that laissez-faire economics, classical economics, neoclassical economics, that was all wrong. It was too abstract. It glorified markets when all they could see was market failure everywhere they looked. You know, they could see nothing but poverty and destitution. And of course, there was plenty of poverty and destitution in the 1880s and 1890s. Anywhere you looked in the world, there were poor people. And a lot of them. Because no economy in the world at that time was highly productive. So productive that it could provide a high level of living for every member of society. So yes, there were a lot of poor people. There were people in destitution, no doubt about it. But what we know in retrospect is that things were getting better for the masses, not worse, wherever laissez-faire had a fighting chance. And Ely and his progressive friends did not understand that. Well, Ely and his comrades proved to be very influential. Let me give you just one example. Ely trained a student at Hopkins called John Commons. And Commons became a very prominent American economist in the first part of the 20th century. And after he graduated, he went out and became a professor at the University of Wisconsin. And Wisconsin became a kind of hotbed of the welfare state, first devising measures to be used at the state level by the government of Wisconsin, but always promoting these more widely so that others would adopt the same policies, and perhaps even the national government would adopt them eventually, because some programs didn't work well at the state level, like unemployment insurance. If you required every employer in Wisconsin to provide unemployment insurance, well, that was just a good way to get employers to move out of Wisconsin and shift their production to some other state where they didn't have to fulfill that requirement. Okay? So the progressives concluded, we have to have a national unemployment insurance program. And eventually they got one. Okay? Ely gave rise to Commons, and Commons trained a man named Edwin Witte. W-I-T-T-E. Witte was not much of an economist, but he knocked around and rubbed shoulders with politicians in Wisconsin. And eventually he got himself appointed the chairman of a committee appointed by President Roosevelt in 1934 called the Committee on Social Security. And he and that committee wrote the legislation that became the Social Security Act, enacted in 1935, the very heart and soul of the modern American welfare state. So blame Ely via Commons, via Witte. Okay? It's easy to trace, and there's no doubt about it, because we can see the influence passing from one of these to the other. So this sort of thing was going on. The Germans proved very influential in the creation of the American welfare state indirectly. In the early 20th century, some of the activity of the welfare status took place at the state level in providing aid to widows and orphans. This was a kind of expansion of the old poor law. actually. But these programs became bigger, better funded, better organized in almost every state by 1930. In the late 19th and early 20th century, we had dual development on the ideological front, first among clergymen of something called the social gospel. Of course, Christians had always understood that caring for the poor was a duty. I mean, if you don't understand that, you haven't even dipped into the Bible. And before that, before Christianity came into being, caring for the poor was a duty of Jews. So Christians understood that caring for the poor and for the other misfortunate people was part of their obligation, and they had done that in many ways. I mentioned the monasteries in England that gave assistance to destitute people. But this was a kind of function undertaken all over the Christian world. So there wasn't anything odd about it. And you might think, okay, we've got that one covered. What is this social gospel movement? Well, this was a movement among people who were, I should say, not really very fired up about theology. They belonged to churches that had become solidified and formalized in their rituals and their doctrine. And they were the kind of Christians that basically just go through the motion on Sunday morning. You know, the kind that's easy to mock because they deserve mockery. Okay? But these people felt guilty about it, apparently. And so they began to say, you know, what the church ought to be doing is not trying to save people's souls. It ought to be trying to save their bodies. You know, if people are hungry, they need to be fed. If they don't have adequate shelter and clothing, they need to be sheltered and clothed. This is the first obligation Christians should be attending to. They shouldn't be worried about fine points of theology. And so the social gospel became, you know, quite all the rage in some Protestant churches in the late 19th century. Some of their preachers became famous, and even more so in the early 20th century. And this movement didn't die then. It continued, and it has a strong presence even in many of the churches today. Okay? And it went hand in hand with progressive ideology. The progressives who wanted to promote the welfare state, who wanted to promote a more activist government at every level, to interfere in the economy, to assist the poor, and to take all kinds of other measures, some of them quite unsavory, like eugenics, racial discrimination, little things like that. Now, when the Great Depression came, it was a tremendous boost to people who were thinking along these German progressive lines. Even though many people then were in economic difficulty because the economy had collapsed, not because of any kind of structural flaws, nonetheless, there were a lot of people suddenly plunged into economic difficulty. People unemployed, many more than ever before. 1933, 25% of the labor force totally out of work, another 25% working part-time when they wanted full-time work. So there's no doubt a lot of people were in economic difficulty. So these friends of the welfare state said, this is our chance. This is our chance. Not just to relieve these people's immediate problems, which they did through agencies such as the Federal Emergency Relief Administration, the Public Works Administration, the Works Progress Administration, the National Youth Administration, the Civilian Conservation Corps. If you've ever taken a course in U.S. history, you know that part of the problem you encounter is learning what all these acronyms stand for. Because when the New Deal comes along, it's acronym city. Okay? So you got to learn what all these things stand for. But more than that was the permanent changes the New Deal wanted to make, like the Social Security Act. The Fair Labor Standards Act of 1938 provided for a national minimum wage, a national maximum work week, initially 44 hours, but quickly scheduled to decline to 40 hours a week. Payment of 50% premium for work above the maximum work week. So overtime pay got paid at time and a half rates. And other provisions to provide what was called decent working conditions, to forbid the employment of young children and so forth. Okay? So this was applied nationally. No longer was it a haphazard state-by-state program. And over time, the Social Security Act kept getting revised. I put in 1956, disability insurance was added. The biggest addition of all in 1965, Medicare and Medicaid were joined to the Social Security system. So when we put all these together, we have the bulk in terms of money of the modern American welfare system. So I don't have time to flesh out the GI Bill from 1944, which is another enormous welfare system for veterans. Providing all kinds of assistance to them, including educational benefits, unemployment assistance, training, money to go to college or trade school. And after that, every American war has had a new GI Bill, so that now it's just considered de rigueur by American politicians that if they have a war, they got to have a new GI Bill. So this keeps adding on and bulking up the welfare system. What's the effect? Well, it has a multitude of effects, but some of them are easy to measure because we can look at the amount of money consumed by the welfare system, at least by parts of it. Here I'm displaying welfare benefits relative to wages and salaries over a period of a little over 50 years. And what you see there is that relative to wages and salaries, welfare back in the 1960s was a very small element. It was about 9-10% ratio at that time. You see, after the great changes of the 1960s in the so-called Johnson programs, and some additions under Nixon even, but mainly under Johnson, we have these new welfare state measures. It begins to grow quicker, then it has ups and downs, but it has a tendency upward, and it has an enormous surge just in the last few years since the financial debacle of 2008. So now that ratio has gone from maybe 9 or 10% to 36% or even more, if I could extend the data up to today. Another measure, real, that is, it's corrected for changes in the price level, real federal means-tested welfare spending. Means-tested spending is that it requires the recipient to qualify by having a low income, okay? Or by having some other eligibility condition like a disability. Okay? Non-means tested includes such things as old age pensions. You don't have to be poor to get a Social Security old age pension. If Bill Gates wants to take his Social Security pension when the time comes, he'll be eligible. Okay? But not Carlos Slim. He's a foreigner. Well, what happens here? It goes from almost zero in 1950 up to getting close to $1 trillion a year. Now, think about this. The entire GDP of the United States now is about $18 trillion. So this is a very large amount of money. And this is just the means-tested part. It doesn't even include gigantic other parts that are not means tested. Here's real federal transfer payments of all kinds. So here we've got the Social Security back in there and everything, it's whether it's means tested or not. And we measure this back here in in 2010 dollars, and we find that back in 1960, it's a small amount, and it grows rapidly, and even more rapidly. It looks exponential, doesn't it? It looks as if you're going to fit a curve to it. It would be an exponential growth curve, not a linear curve to fit it, because it certainly turns up in the past 15 years or so. And here's another measure, federal entitlement spending. Entitlement means all you got to do to qualify to receive these benefits is show that you satisfy the eligibility requirements. It doesn't require that Congress provide funds specifically devoted to fulfilling this need every year. Congress just stands ready under existing legislation to fund every benefit under these entitlement programs that people qualify for. So if you're qualified for an old age pension or disability payment or for Medicaid assistance, if you're qualified for Medicare payments to your medical service providers, and Medicare is basically imposed on everybody 65 years old or older, it's almost impossible not to join. And there's a heavy tax while people are working paid toward Medicare. But nonetheless, this entitlement spending has become more and more a tremendous part of the whole federal budget. And I could keep giving you series like that, but there's a point to it all. When you have something growing exponentially like that, and it's already a big part of the government budget or a big part of the economy, you know that that can't continue forever. It just can't happen. So what can't happen will not happen. So we know that this kind of change in the fiscal dimensions of the welfare system will stop. We don't know the level at which it will stop, and we don't know the exact details by which it will be compelled to stop. I have a kind of general feeling that politicians will look as hard as they can to find ways to disguise what they're doing so they won't be punished by voters for withholding benefits. But they have to withhold the benefits at some point because they have no choice. So there are many ways that this system can crack up, but it's going to crack up in one way or another. It can't continue as it has for the past 50 or 60 years. It's impossible. So, you know, this is like a hopeful thing for some of us. We look at these terrible government programs and we say, oh God, you know, they're going to go on forever. They're going to ruin the whole solar system. Well, this time we know they won't, because they can't. No matter how evil and horrible government officials are, even they cannot do the impossible. So this will end, but it'll be very interesting for you young people to live long enough to see the exact details of how it ends. Thanks a lot.